we should start. Other people who will be joining late can start doing that subsequently. So good evening, everyone. After a bit of hassle, we have started again. You know, I am Romil. I'm your host for Passion Talks. Yes, last time I missed out because of our exams. And today we are extremely honored to have with us Claudia. And, you know, this is very, very difficult to imagine because 2 days back, I was just thinking, you know, after speaking to her, that how could somebody have 500, you know, that number itself, because before this, I've never met anyone who has done even 100 or 100 as a number as far as the marathons and ultra marathons are concerned. So it's very, very proud privilege for us to have her all the way from Germany. And we thank Preetam for introducing her to us. And then he was kind enough. And then Claudia, again, extremely grateful. And I must say, the last time I spoke to you about 2 to 3 days back, immediately I messaged to all our friends. I said, you know, the kind of energy she has, it's amazing, you know. And I'm sure that is the energy which carries you through to these numbers, which are somewhat unimaginable, because I am someone who does one marathon a year or maximum 2 to 3, and then imagining 500 years I'll have to live to complete to that distance and that kind of achievement. We are really honored to have you here. And to set the ball rolling, we would like you to introduce yourself and start from how you all started running and how that numbers and all.
So that's that then? Romil? Yeah?
Yeah. I accidentally muted Romil, but yeah, let's start.
Good. Okay, I will start then. Yes. We cannot hear Romil anymore, I think. It's a problem. Okay, I start. Good. Yeah, Claudia Cavaleiro from Germany. Thank you very much for inviting me to that passion talk. And for me, it's a big honor to talk about my passion, what is running for many, many years. And as you already mentioned, I have big achievements. I have done this 500 marathons. Within the 5 marathons, I have done as well ultra races. So I will share a little bit where it started with me, and you can go with me to the through the journey, and for sure I share more questions, experience with you. So I grew up in Germany in a little village. In that village, people normally do not go for running. Nobody has an interest. I'm the only one going for races, for running. And what happened in the beginning is that I liked running as a child already. So I was at the school running, and the school teacher discovered me, and he said, oh, you're running, you love running, go to your first competition. And I wanted to share that one because it's very special. I was going to my first competition. I was around 14 years old, and it was a 3 kilometer only competition. And I was running with all the others, and I want to be first. And this is my first ever race I won. But as I finished, I was going into, everything went black and I was going down, and they had to help me and settling down. And then I waked up and they told me, you did run, you did great. And here is the radio, please give an interview. So that was my first experience. I was overrunning doing it because I was, you know, my eyes black. And so, but I was staying in running then. And first, in the couple of years I have done from 14 to 19, lots of races. I was even doing from sprint 100 meter in the stadium to 10 kilometer races, etc. So that was always my passion and I liked it. And then as I was around 20, they asked me if I can hand over medals to the marathon runners at the finish. I was running 10 kilometers in that city. And then they said, oh, we need some volunteers to hand over the medals for the marathon in 3 hours. And I said, sure, I do that. I'm happy to do the handover. So I was standing at the finish. We had around 3,000 people finishing this marathon. And I was doing this medal giving. And doing that, I thought, boah, they are all so great. And they're smiling and they're happy. What is that about, marathon? It seems to be something really, really cool. So during that day, as I hand over the medals, I decided I want to do my first marathon. So, and I came up and I started to train, and with my first marathon then. And as I was training for my first marathon, I've taken a couple of months, I think it was around 3 months, and every week I was going with 10 kilometer, with 20 kilometer, and once per week, 30 kilometer. I was very disciplined. But I shared with you, I came from just 100 meter, 10 kilometer. So in my first marathon, I was training a lot and I was building from like zero to marathon. And at this time, it was very difficult because I got an injury. So I was able to finish my first marathon in really great time, below 4 hours, which is super cool. But I had then to cope with having an injury because I have done too much in once. So, and already it's my first, after my first marathon I ran, I learned that I need to keep my pace. I need to think about how much power my body has. You know, it's a balance of what your body has and what you can deliver. So I had a couple of months learning to, you know, training as much as you can, listen into your body. Don't run too fast, just take the pace you can run. And I was able to run marathons again. And then I had a couple of years where I was running this, what you mentioned, the 1 or 2 marathons a year, not more. Because I was thinking, look, after 1 marathon, I was for weeks really tired and I was like hurting my pains and it was my body. And I thought 1 marathon and I need a 6 month break. And then I do my next marathon again. So that I have done a couple of years. So at this time, you could have asked me, will you be the lady in 20 years later, have been running 500 marathons? I would have said, I never can run my 500 marathons. So that would have been my answer. Yeah. Then I was meeting some friends and they told me they running, and the name of also the friends were all in one club in Germany. The name of the club in Germany is 100 Marathon Club Germany.
She's a German.
Yeah. What is the club saying? That are the people were able to finish 100 marathons in total. And then you are this club member. So it's very nice. It's like a honor. And you are famous. When you say in Germany, we have 80 million people living there. And there are, I would say, 300 in this club. So you can see already this is a very famous thing. So I met this friend and he said to me, and I said, I have only a couple of, let's say, maybe 20 marathons. I will not be able to have 100. And he said to me, no way. I tell you, you just think about collecting until 100 marathons and you do some marathons as you do usually and you will achieve that. Yeah. What I've done then, I was doing more marathons, but that I learned, and now is already the big learning I would like to share. I had to go slower. I couldn't do all the time the below 4 hours anymore, because when you really run fast, your body is tired. And then 1 week or 2 weeks later, you will be not able to run again. So I learned to have a different pace. And yes, I'm tired after the marathon, but I was not so tired anymore with keeping the pace at the right level. It was like, I could say, can I say more relaxed? A more relaxed pace. Yeah. And then I was going for that. And then I did really achieve this 100 marathons. And it was a big celebration. I was in the newspaper and I was joining this wonderful club. And I have to say, my body was getting used to it. The interesting thing, when you start to do these things more often, like what I have done every week, a marathon, every weekend, 1 marathon. And my body started to be used to it. And I found it very exciting that I was able to do that, because many people talked to me and said, oh, how you can do that? This is impossible. But I tell you again, it's about the speed you do it, about the pace, and listen to your body, right? And I always say as well, when you are doing the race and you're pushing yourself forward and you're getting tired doing the race, then take this moment where you are more tired. You take a little break, a sit for a moment. Or you walk or some whatever it is, and then you will get recovered and go again. So, and then I was going further. And finally, I did achieve this 500. But what I have done at this time as well, I was discovering you can go further as marathon. So I was like, oh, interesting. So people shared with me, oh, I'm doing a 100-kilometer race. And I said, 100-kilometer? Oh, my God, how you can do that? It's like 2.5 marathons in one distance. How I can do that? And I was then training for it with doing my marathon at the weekend. And I started as well to do 2 marathons at the weekend. Because then I had 80 kilometers in 2 days. And people told me, yes, when you do that, you will be able to run this 100 kilometer. And then I was doing this 100 kilometer first time. And what was happening doing that race was very special. I learned a lot, by the way. And maybe I can share it with you just for your experience that you know what you can learn, right? I learned that I was getting tired during the race. At 70 kilometer, I was so tired that I thought I can go no step anymore. But the head is making you finish, right? So I was overcoming this one and going further. What I met as another person was as well tired. So I learned as well, go when you're really tired and there are more people in the race. Maybe you find a friend in the race, you don't know this person, but normally when you have the same pace, you will be friends for this race and you will go together and help each other. Because this other person can motivate you. So I met another person, we motivated each other. I learned as well a lot about my shoes. I had very thin shoes, what are street runner shoes, like these shoes where I would say our marathon winners wearing, yeah? So they were too thin, and I got really blister and a lot of pains at this race. So we finished together with this guy. And today when I see him in other races, I always say, hello, great to see you. You helped me like 10 years ago. Yeah. So it's really nice. It was really nice. I learned for myself that I had to take other shoes. You know, more the shoes where you have more, I would say, where your feet is more protected with a bigger. And I learned as well that socks are important. Do not have blisters. So another tip I would like to give on blisters is there are this, I need to look the English name. The name is 2-layer socks. When you're running for very long distances, and I would even recommend for marathon, take the 2-layer socks. They have 2 layers. And then it's not your feet doing that. Just the socks is doing it and your feet will stay protected and you don't get the blisters. So 2 big learnings at my first race. Yeah.
Maybe. So, yeah. So what were the timelines like? So you ran your first marathon in 1991. And so when did you decide that you wanted to target 100 marathons? Did you actually find out about this
one? I got the 100 marathons, I need to think about 1991. 2005, something like that. Yeah. Okay. Something like that.
So for 14 years, you were continuously running at the rate of like 1 or 2 marathons per year?
A couple of years only. No, I have done like 2 years, couple of marathons, and then I started already to do a lot of marathons. 2-3 years. Yeah. And then I was going for more, exactly. Yeah. And as I say, then I started in 2009 to doing the 100 kilometer, and I have done a couple of that. And then in 2015, I decided to do my first 100 miles race. And I can tell you, this is when you say this is marathon, then you go for 100 kilometers and then you go for 100 miles. And it's very different because when you do the 100 miles.
Sorry, Claudia, just a minute. I think it's okay. Claudia, are you able to hear me now? Okay. I cannot quite. Just a minute. Let me just check how to unmute you. Just a minute. Okay.
Looks like Claudia is on mute. Claudia, looks like you're on mute.
Yeah, can you unmute yourself? If, I cannot quite see how to do that. No.
Not yet, Claudia. I can't hear you yet. Yes, yeah, now
yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, you put me on mute. So where we standing was 100 miles, right?
So, okay. So in 2015, you completed your first 100 mile run.
Yes. So, and this was very hard. I learned a lot around pain. So I can tell as experience that when you do 100 miles, it goes to your body. You have a lot, or you have to have a good mindset and willingness to finish. So at this race, I made very interesting experience. You know, I shared 100 kilometer that I learned to run the 100 kilometer. And when you have done 100 kilometer at 100 miles, you still have 60 to go, right? Mm-hmm. And you're thinking, it's only 60. I can do that. But you're getting tired because your body pay back because you had this 100 kilometer. So at 130 kilometer at this race, I was very tired. And I couldn't go anymore, but I said, oh no, I need to finish, I want to finish. And they were really young men, and they were really like, they looked like Iron Man. And they were laying in front of me, and they were sleeping and had pains, and they said, oh, we will stop. And I looked at them and I said, guys, you're much more fit than me. I'm a woman, I'm totally tired, but you, look at your body, you can do that. And they didn't finish. And I was going further. And for me, it was so. I was then arriving in that stadium where you had go a 400 meter thing, right? 400 meter round. And I was running it. Like, I was like, I pushed myself to jog for jogging and doing that 400 meter. And I still, when I talk about them getting this freezing on my skin, I was crying in tears. It was like such an achievement, 100 miles. You, when you start in the morning and then on the next day you arrive, you can never believe you can make it. So it's like very, very incredible. And when you start, you have full of fears that you cannot make it. But when you then finish, this feeling, it's you cannot describe. It's just very, very, very nice, very emotional. Yeah. Yeah.
So you had made a video from the Halter Rennsteig Run that you had done as a self-supported run. So do you do long distance runs that you do by yourself, which are not part of longer, which are not part of organized events?
So you see, if I go just by myself or with other people, or
yeah.
So I want to share, because you asked me as well, and I have written it down for myself, how my I'm going with my husband together. He likes running too. And we are now having around, from my 500 marathons, we have 200 all together. So, yes, my husband, he has, I need to calculate, 600. So he has 100 more. So, and he has 200 with me together. So we both have done independent this excessive running and doing all the races. And we did meet in the race. And yes, later we got married. So, and now we're running that together. And there we were pushing us through this 100 miles race, what I was sharing. And later we pushed us together to do the 100 miles of mountain race. And I did share to the group a video of that. What was the name was UNOT 170 kilometer. You must, when you have seen that in YouTube, you may look it up. And this is again a very different thing. When you go in the mountains and you're doing height meters, and this 170 kilometer having 5,400 height meter. So very, very heavy. And this is another thing where you learn you will need more time, more hours for 10 kilometer, more hours for 20 kilometer, because you like climbing up a mountain and your air is going like, Jurassic Nonstop Ultra Run, exactly that one. So you really, and you have seen some pictures where I'm nicely jogging down, right, running down. But I can tell you, you see the pictures as well where I'm walking up. Because your air, you just have not enough oxygen. And you need, and this is what I learned as well. We are famous, my husband and me, for walk and run. That means we're running it when it goes straight, when it goes down, we're running and we are very well running. When it goes up, we're walking. And what we're doing with that and what I want to share as well is, it's the speeds versus distance. When you go long distance, you need to calculate your speed. How much power has your body? When you're running too fast in the beginning, you may not finish at the end of the race. So that's what we learned in this doing this races as well. Yeah. And I asked today as well my husband, what should I share when I talk about this long races, like this Jurasteig non-stop ultra trail? And one thing is important. And when you go, don't think at the start, today I'm going for 170 kilometers. You should think, look, I go one step after another. Yeah. Each step will bring me closer to the finish. And I go from aid station to aid station. So I have like a big cake of 170 kilometers, but I cut my cake into 20 kilometer pieces. And then you start first 20. And important, what I want to advise is as well, don't think about how far it is still. Celebrate how far you are. As example, you go, you say, I have 20 kilometer. I have 40, I have a marathon. I have 80, two marathons, yay. 120, I have three marathons. I'm so tired. And then you think, oh my God, it's one marathon more. No, it's one marathon more, I can do it. So you always have to be and with your mind and telling your mind. Your mindset is very important. Because in the moment where you are, let's say you do the 170 and you are very tired. I was very tired at 70 kilometer already and I had still 100 to go. And I was taking a break. And after the break, I was able to go further. And that's another thing I want to share. When you want to go far, and you know that, I think it's a famous slogan. You say, go slow when you want to go far. Yeah. And this is what we learned. And what we learned as well, when you really like out of energy, take a little break. And it can be after 5 or even after 10 minutes, you will be good again. Just sit down for, don't push yourself, sit down, relax, drink, eat something, go again, and it's going. You can do that, yeah? And interesting is, you may now think, oh, she finished everything, she's just great, and all is good. But when you talk with ultra runners, you will learn as well that you have a DNF, did not finish. Yeah. And I never wanted to have any DNF in my life, but it happened to me. It happened. And I learned through it. As example, I had one DNF. So the 100 miles in Berlin, I shared this picture where I'm standing in front of this nice wall. Could you share that, Milan? Do you have this picture? Where I'm just, with a green shirt in the wall. Maybe when you have that.
Yeah. I did just a minute. Continue.
Yeah, yeah. I share. So at this race, I have finished 4 times.
Okay.
And one time I did not finish. And as I did not finish, happened the following with me. I was very tired and I was not able to eat and drink so well because I was feeling not so good. So eating and drinking was a problem. And I lost my energy and my power. But I was still in the race. And then I lost my brain, my mindset that I can do it. And at around 130 kilometer, I was telling myself, I cannot do it. At the next aid station, I will go out. And I said, I will stop. And my husband said, okay. And and when you cannot do it anymore, we stop. And we decided before the next aid station already that I will go out. So that's the race where I finished, by the way. But in that race, another year, so 4 times I finished. That's a picture from Berlin, 100 miles. And in 1 year, I was tired at 130 kilometer, or it was around 127. And I said to my husband, I cannot go anymore. We were stopping, and we said we go out. And honestly, later, I said, when I would have waited and make the break, maybe I could have gone further. And I learned, don't decide before you do the break that you will stop the race. Do the break first and then decide. Big learning. We're always applying it now. And my poor husband, I'm telling him now, even couple of, it's now, let me think, it's 2 years ago, and I'm still telling him, why did you let me not finish? Why you didn't push me? You should have pushed me to go further. So you see, that's one of the experience. But I think the did not finish is something that you need to learn too. I had only one, that's okay. But however, it brings you further and it helps you as well to learn. You look, when you think you cannot go anymore, don't think it will be, you can go further. You can push your limit. And maybe that brings me as well to the point you asked me to share. It's about nutrition and sport. Some differences. When you run a marathon, you take this ultra gels, you know, you must know the gels, you get this high energy thing, what you can drink or you can eat, banana, I would say some little power bar in small pieces, you drink ISO, you drink electrolytic drinks, you're drinking water, that's what you do normally at the marathon. When you go for the long things like 100 and 160 kilometer, you're drinking more Coca-Cola, soft drinks with sugar because you need power. You get power from the sugar. Yeah, yeah. You drink, you eating nut bars, kind bars, you ask me. Yes, kind bars are perfect for ultra distances because nuts are really good. You can even eat pasta in between and make a break. You may eat even a little piece of pizza. So when you do 170 kilometer, you need to eat different things because your body need to get more energy. Right? And that's what I wanted to share as well for eating stuff for, with you. What will be important as well when you really want to go for the long, long, long races. Yeah?
how do you manage your digestion? I mean, can you eat heavy things like pasta during a race?
That's a very good question. So in my first 100 miles race in Berlin, I learned from my head. So in the marathons, I never eat any pasta. I never eat potatoes or pizza, right? Never. Because in the marathon, you're trying being faster and you eat maybe a banana, maybe one power bar. But then my husband told me, and it was like after 120 kilometers, you need to eat something, otherwise, and you get hungry. And I was eating pasta with tomato sauce. And I have to say, I was feeling bad. And I had 20 kilometers telling, I'm feeling not good. So I learned for myself, I cannot eat pasta with tomato sauce. And you need to learn it for yourself. What can you eat? What is well going? So I would either eat pasta with nothing, or I eat potatoes, or I can eat as well pizza. So you need to learn for yourself. Everybody is very different, right? And it's something what you can try and not like me, just eating a shelf of pasta and then you feel bad. Maybe you eat little pieces as advice and then you learn what you can eat. Later I learned to eat one potato, one small piece of pizza, and then you eat and you think, okay. And then over the time you know what you can eat. So that's as well big advice for me. Yeah. And I always eat, I can eat chocolate or nut bars. This is very good and it gives lots of energy. Kind bars are very well known at ultra runners and they love it to eat them because it brings nut, nice taste, and you get energy for the next few hours. Right?
Amazing. So yeah, granola bars are widely used by mountaineers, even in their expeditions as well. So another detail that I would like to share about Claudia is that in 2013, she was appointed as honorary professor at the Niederrhein University of Applied Sciences. And to celebrate that, in 2013, she started a marathon in her own backyard, the Süchtelner-Höhen-Marathon. So can you share your experiences?
So my organizer experience, right? As organizer, So as I was, and by the way, it came, I need to share how it came, because that's an interesting story as well. So as I was so I'm working at Mars, at KIND now, and I'm, I studied chemistry, and I'm a technology scientist, okay? And I was already for 10 years giving lectures additional to Mars. I was going to university, 6 times a year and giving lectures about technology, nutrition, food science, etc. And after 10 years, the university made me a professor. And I was thinking, oh, that's a very cool thing. I will be a professor. And I love running, you know, and I shared a lot of nutrition stuff with my runners. I will invite my runners that are my friends for an own marathon, what I organize in my backyard. And I've done that. So the first thing is you need to get. So I, first of all, I was asking another organizer how to do that. So I got a friend and I was doing a marathon with him together. And during the marathon, 42 kilometer, we talked all the time about how to organize a marathon. Then I was going home. He told me, number one, you need to measure the distance. You may remember in the city marathons, you have a blue line. What are the 42 kilometer measured, right? You may have seen that. So they're painting a blue line on the street. So I was thinking, what could I do? And I was going for, you can still, that's 100 times at my home. Super cool. Very nice. That was as I already have done 100 of these marathons organized. So I did measure the distance. It's 6.5 rounds, 6.4 kilometer. And that are my friends. They have done several marathons with me together in that. So you see, they have a starting number. You need that. You need to have a time measurement, and you need to have good stuff for eating and drinking, water, electrolytic drinks. And this is later, 400 marathons later, where I finished with my husband. That's my husband, together the marathon, my 500th marathon. The 500th marathon was this year in January. You can see it was a bit wet and cold weather. And yes, we finished there together. So here you can see exactly the organization in my race. So that's my own race. And we have always around 20 members going the 6.5 rounds Süchtelner-Höhen, what is a little nature, where here is a little bit mounty, etc. And what is really nice, all my friends coming there, and we do it together. We calculate the time, they get a certificate, exactly. We're doing a start, you can say on the right side, the husband with the long hair, and myself, it's with a blonde hair, you know me now. And then you give them some instructions, 6.5 round. You have to do, you have to mark where they have to run. So normally that I do on the earth, so I'm doing some arrows with nice colors. And then they all go, we're going together. Exactly, yes. That are the friends of us. Yes. That's about the organization of the marathon. Yeah, that's my husband again. And there you can see, yes, my husband. And here you can see how we start. And then they start and they go 6.5 rounds and they're getting something to eat back when they come back every round.
Yeah, so this is one of your aid stations.
Yeah, you can see what we have to eat. No, we have some fruits, we have some nuts, we have some salty stuff, we have water, normally we have Coca-Cola. This is a lady, a wife from one of the runners. She was volunteering to stand there and applauding us and motivating us during the race. So in general, I can say the aid station, that is one of the aid stations we have. It's always good to have people there motivating the runner. Yeah, and it's very important to have good stuff at the aid station so that the runners, you can see, can drink and getting motivated, and then they go further.
Amazing, amazing. So for running these 500 marathons, you must have done a lot of traveling. So how do you maintain a work-life balance? How to maintain a traveling schedule?
That's a very good question. So. I normally learned that I'm doing my races on the weekends. So during the week, I'm working. That's fine and good. And honestly, I'm then already looking forward on Friday to my Saturday, Sunday, because I take my races as work by life balance, collecting energy back. I shared with you, I do walk and run. We do it not too fast. We don't push us too much. We talking, we make some breaks, and we do. It's important for us to be in the nature, to be with my husband. So with that, my work-life balance, I'm together with my husband. And as well, you heard from me that a round at the marathon has 6.4 kilometer. So my son, I have two sons, one is 17 years and one is 11 years. they often join one or two of the rounds. So then, and after that, they go to their own sport, what is football training and football games. So often before or after football, they will come with me and doing 6.4 kilometer. Like when I have to do the six rounds, I have one round, one son, and the other round, the other son. So and then we talk and go together. And yes, I can tell you, my 17 years old, I'm not really able to go with him anymore because he's really fast. He can run 4 minutes per kilometer. He's super fast. Very difficult to go with him. My smaller son, 11 years old, he's still very fine with my pace. So we are very happy still together. But I've learned as well, my sons are faster, right? My older son, 17 years, he even has done a marathon as he was 12 because he wanted to join me. What was a bit crazy, and I tried to demotivate him and to tell him, don't do it. But he really wanted to do it. So he has as well one marathon experience. But I taught him, look, football, stay in football. That's your thing. It's important to you. Go for it. That's great. And so that means work-life balance for us is the different sports. And often after the race, when I'm running at home this with my own marathon, I would be ready around 2 o'clock. I'm starting early. And then I can go and watch football at my kids. So I really, we really try to balance. We all love sport. And for us, it's sport balance, honestly. Yeah, that's our like. Working in the week and the weekend doing the sport. And then Sunday evening, and normally after some races and being in the nature, I'm normally refreshed with my mindset and my energy. Even when I'm a bit tired because my body is tired from a long race.
Yeah. Amazing. So one thing that I noticed from your from the pictures that you shared is that you use trekking poles for your ultra marathon. So can you share, so trekking poles is not something that are widely used currently in India in the trail running scene. In fact, trail running in India is still at a very nascent stage. So can you, give us insights about how you prepare for trail running races as opposed to a road race? And how do you
mean for the mountain races against the road race? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, it's a good one. So for the road race, it's a bit more, I find it more easy because I'm just going, I'm going to do some longer distance running and then I go for my road marathon. And then I go normally more the straight, accurate distances. I find it more easy because you just can train on the street, you go for 20, 30, 40 kilometer, you're training, and then you go to your next race where you have like, you're going to city marathon, whatever, yeah? For the mountain marathon, you need to invest more time. It would mean you say on a Saturday, and today before I came to you, I have done some training for mountain marathon. You say I'm starting at 8 o'clock in the morning, and I go the whole day until 3 o'clock, or normally until 5. But today I've done until 3 o'clock because I wanted to be with you. So you say, okay, from 8 to 3 o'clock, we go and we search really for these mountains to go up and down, to feel as well exhausted and climbing, running down, climbing, running down. So I really go in the more mountain nature. And having done that, it totally helps to be able to finish that race then. Yes. Tracking tool, I want to say, we take normally the normal GPS tracking. You can buy the small things where you can put your distance on it and you can then track where you are on such a blue line you're making for yourself, yeah. Or you take or you buy some of this nice Nike watch or TomTom watch or whatever it is. You can do it with watches too, right? It doesn't matter. All tracking tools are working. And then you look at your watch and you're seeing how many kilometers you have. Often I have doing the same distance because I know this distance is very mountain, and I go on this weekend on 2 weeks back or on 3 weeks back the same distance. Then I don't need to track because I know how many kilometers it has. Right. Yeah.
Roman, any more questions from you?
Let me check what I wanted to share.
Yeah, you know, I would have lots and lots of questions, but then I think I'll keep the time in mind. You know, first of all, I really like your whole concept of, you know, playing the mind games wherein you say you have done 20 kilometers and only this much is left. You don't bother much about what is left. You know, it gives you a sense of accomplishment Because, you know, only a runner who has done so much would understand, you know, how it feels once you have to do a 100-miler or such humongous distances. You know, so tell us, you know, how do you condition your brain to such kind of, what other kind of tricks do you apply to successfully finish such kind of races?
Yes, so I think it's about this passion and motivation. There is one slogan, my husband and me saying often before we do a race, the slogan is, you really need to want this. Yeah, means, so it's like this. When I want to run 100 kilometers, as example, we have, by the way, I'm organizing a 100 kilometer race at my home. You remember my marathon distance, 6.5 rounds. 100 kilometer is 15.5 rounds. So we always say, and by the way, our finisher quote is not high for that. We have good people that finish. My husband finished all the time. But it was, we really wanted. Right. It doesn't matter for us, it's 15.5 rounds. We want to do today 100 kilometer. I really want to finish because I know, and that's my motivation I want to share. When I have done it, I will feel hugely happy. I will feel proud. I will feel I have something accomplished. I will feel satisfied. There's so many feelings at the finish. So that means, Milan, when you ask me, what is making you, how you make your head up? I'm thinking about, do I want it? Yes. And then I think about what happens when I have done it. So that I paint, and I would name it a vision. It's vision painting. I paint the picture. Then I finish. I paint the picture of 100 miles Berlin. When I will run in this nice stadium, people will applaud me. I go there and I will be like, yeah. So I paint my own picture as well about the finish. I paint my picture about the breaks I will do in the race. It's all around this wanting and vision. Good.
Right. Okay. You know, another question which I have, you know, I've realized if my natural pace is, let's say, 6 km/h, right? Or let's say something, whatever, arbitrary. It's very difficult for me to run slower than that. You started off with a pace which was, you know, less than four hours a marathon. And then you had to slow down because you wanted longevity. You know, there's a lot of mental strength which is involved to run slow when you can run fast. How do you do that?
I can advise two things. One thing, at my first 100 miles race, I was running the first 60 kilometers too fast, and then I had so many pains that I learned I need to be slow. So there are two things. You can learn it through your own pains. Just say, today I will do 50 kilometers, and you run first too fast, and then you still finish, and you think next time I will be slower in the beginning. Or another trick, and maybe an advice, is just train it for yourself in the training. Yeah, just try to go slow, and listen to your body, and maybe take a friend with you. Maybe take a friend that's a bit slower than you, and you talk with this friend, and then you will recognize it's easy to go slower. Oh, now it's 1 hour later, I was slower, and I'm feeling great. Oh, not too bad to be slower. So make this experiences maybe as an advice.
Okay. So I guess that's the reason you don't run with your elder son, and then choosing the younger son is the reason behind all this, your pacing plan, huh?
Yeah, funny story from last week. My in the stadium, my younger son said to me, Mom, I want to run fast 1 kilometer with you. And I was doing it. And believe me, I was so exhausted more than after 100 kilometers. And I said to my son, okay, I do you this favor sometimes, but I will not do it so often to you because I know running fast is as well very exhausting. It's nice because you feel the speed, but when you then go for the long distance, it may make some problems, right?
True, that's right. You know, we would request audience if they want to ask any questions. One question which we have received from others is, you know, they want to know, you never thought that you would do 500, but now you have done 500. So what next you would look forward to? Maybe some other target you have in mind?
You mean as a topic as running or what you mean?
No, another target. You know, you had a target of, let's say, 100, then 500. Yeah.
Yeah, so, yeah, that's a good thing. So, maybe I wanted to share because my husband and me wanted to run this 200 kilometer. Remember, we wanted to push the boundary of 200 kilometer. What was very, and we have done that. What was very heavy. We have done it only once. So maybe my one of the next goals is for us two things. One thing is do another thing around 200 kilometer. We know it's very exhausting. And another thing we're thinking about is doing etap races. So you're running every day. And I've done that one around 40 to 60 kilometer. I've done once an etap race of 6 days, but we're thinking as well of goals like, can we run 7 days, 8 days, 9 days in a row? Something like that could be next targets.
Wonderful. Amazing, amazing. You know, so one last question I want to know is, you know, you mentioned there is a club which is 100 marathon club, you know?
Yeah.
Any club which is greater than that, because 100 marathon club itself was new to us. Do you have anything for 200 marathon club or a 300 or which is, have you ever heard of that?
I can share with you that in nearly every country there is this 100 marathon club, and they name them, even when there are lots of people in this club, they have done even 500 or I know people, they have done 1,000 marathon. One lady, and I know a man, he has done 2,000 marathon, but they are still in the same club as me. And the clubs keep the name. But yes, there are a couple of people, they have done even. So one woman, she's a world record leader. She has more than 1,700 marathons now. She's 79. She will turn 80 this year. And there's a man, he will turn around 60 this year, and he has 2,000 marathons. So that are the big leader of our club. So we, in our club, yes, the same name, same people, but we have leaders in our club. And we're measuring ourselves. And by the way, I'm below the 10 first woman, so I'm very proud.
Amazing, you know. I mean, thank you so much, Claudia. You know, so many things we had to learn today. I mean, because all these things were new, you know, as we said in the beginning itself, we have not found anyone who has done even 100 marathons. And then I came to know that, you know, I know a lot of marathoners, but then 500 was something once we came to know from Preetam, you know, it was a really big achievement, something which we can never imagine. And thank you so much for your time. And thank you so much. Patience for shifting the platform, because only a person with so much of determination, so much of calm inside can, you know, handle such things. Thanks once again. And it was really a pleasure hosting you. And we'll be putting up this link on YouTube. Thanks to Milan, we were able to shift the thing in due time. And we'll be posting and sharing the link with you on YouTube. Thanks once again. Have a good day.
Thank you very much, Milan. To all of you. And do not forget, it's
one step
after another. You can do something as well. All the best. Bye-bye.
Sure, we'll try. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Claudia. Thank you.